Welcome to the Roanoke Valley Convention and Visitors Bureau's 31st annual meeting. And our meeting is about strengthening partnerships tonight, and I thank y'all for being a part of this. This is a little bit of an expanded crowd over what we anticipated when we looked at the Taubman to have this. We were normally have between 240 and 260 people, and I think we are well over 300. So I hope everybody back there can hear me. If not, let me know, and you may not really want to hear what I have to say anyway, but just have a good party. But I'm glad everybody's here with us. I'm sure that the beauty of this location and the appeal of our keynote speaker, why we have over 300 people here. I'd like to welcome you here to the Taubman, and I'm gonna ask Della Watkins to come up a little bit as we talk about the Taubman. But we thought that this was a place that we needed to support, and that's why we picked this venue for tonight's important meeting to us. We have a great event going on here, and if you didn't have time to go see the Rockwell painting exhibit before, you certainly have a chance afterward. And Della's going to tell you about another chance you'll get to see that. But this is one of the major events that the Taubman has done. And I hope everybody in this room will realize the importance of supporting this event. And I'm going to ask Della, please come up as our hostess. We'll give her a minute to talk about her job.
Talk to your ear?
You turn around and talk to me.
Welcome. No, it's you and me.
Have my mic.
Welcome. I'm Della Watkins, the executive director, and certainly am delighted to see all of you all in our atrium tonight. Wanted to let you know that if you did not have a chance to go to the exhibition today, not only is it here through June the 12th, but also in your goodie bags, you'll find a ticket. And this ticket has a very special message for you on the bottom. And it says that we have now deputized you to be our Convention Bureau Ambassador. So what we'd like for you to do is to take this free ticket and make sure that you take it home. Go home and talk to your neighbors and your friends and your the company that's worn out their welcome at your house. Bring them to the museum and be our guests yet again. And we would like to have you anytime. The galleries are full. We call this an American Spring because we have George Washington in the house, contemporary exhibitions, and our own permanent collection back on view, and Rockwell. So thank you for being here.
Della didn't tell you about the very fine print that's on there, but if you bring back 20 guests with you, your admission's free too. Isn't that right, Del? Okay, I thought so. No, actually, that ticket will get you in free, but we hope you will bring 20 people with you to come see this. It is important because this is really one of the first major events that's been held here, and the success of it, I know, will have some determination on what future events are held. So as a community, we need to stand up and make sure that we support this event at the Taubman, and I thank you all for that. We have a number of elected officials, and given we're already running behind, I will ask that all of our elected officials stand both. I think most of our state elected officials are down dealing with the session that took place today to deal with the governor's vetoes, et cetera. So I don't think we have any of our state elected officials, but we certainly have a number of our local elected officials. So if y'all would please stand. Come on, don't be bashful. It's an election year for some of you, so I know you want to stand up and say hi. We'd like to recognize all of our Virginia's Blue Ridge tourism stakeholders, the city of Roanoke and Salem, and the counties of Botetourt, Franklin, and Roanoke. And we also have in that area 176 partners of the Bureau. Tonight is about strengthening destination partnerships and creating a logical path towards our destination vision. And I know many of you all participated in numerous meetings that we had spread throughout the region to go over what needs to be done here and what everybody's dreams are for the next, between now and 2030. I wanted to do 2020 because I thought that'd be cool, but they said you won't accomplish much in that first five, in that short period of time. So we did move it to 2030. So more like my vision is than perfect. But anyway, I hope y'all will enjoy the evening and remember what you've helped us with. Our annual meeting would not be possible without, let me get my clicker here so we can get on cue. I just skipped that first picture because I don't like it being up there. I'd like to thank our sponsors, and we have a number of them, which we appreciate very much tonight. Access, Appalachian Power, Asian American Business Owners Association, Baymont Inn and Suites and Ramada Inn, Botetourt County, Caridian Clinic, City of Roanoke, City of Salem, Franklin County, Hometown Bank, the Hotel Roanoke and Conference Center, Jefferson College of Health Sciences, Lanford Brothers Company, Leisure Media 360, McNeil Roofing, Inc., Biddle and Charlotte Porterfield, Rocky Dale Quarries Corporation, Roanoke County, the Roanoke Times, Town of Vinton, and Virginia Tech. Let's give those sponsors an applause for making this a possible event. A special thanks tonight go to the Taubman Museum of Art, Roanoke Valley TV, which you'll be able to see this presentation. I know people tell me, oh, I saw you giving out awards, and I'm like, where in the world did you see that? And it's RVTV, so you will be able to see that. Photography by Dominion Images, Blue Ridge Catering, Virginia Gentleman Barbershop Quartet, Andy and Jane Catt Musicians. So let's thank them for their being part of our evening tonight. Now I'd like to ask Landon Howard to come up and provide us with an invocation. And I think that's
good evening, everyone. Let's give a blessing to the good Lord. Dear Lord, are so grateful for our country, America, and this beautiful region, Virginia's Blue Ridge, where we are so fortunate to live, work, and call home. Thank you for our business and elected leaders who are so willing to give us the time that we have to make Virginia's Blue Ridge such a great place and help us look forward to a brighter future. Lord, we are blessed to have everyone here in attendance at this event, and we're grateful for this meal and for the many blessings that you give us every day. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, y'all can enjoy your dinner, which is on its way out. And in the meantime, you'll see some slides being presented that show a little bit of what's happening around our region. And we will convene probably in about 30 minutes with the rest of the program. While everyone's enjoying their dinner, and please do continue to enjoy your dinner, I would like to just share a few significant accomplishments for the CVB in 2015. We had a lot of good things going on. I picked, for the sake of time, just a few of them that we thought we'd talk about. Our online marketing increased 16% over last year. We had the equivalent of 11,649 visitors to our website each week. That's kind of hard to imagine when you come up and add that figure together. I questioned the other day, I said, you got 800,000 visitors? And they proved it to me. That is huge for what we have been doing. Visit Virginia Blue Ridge reached an all-time monthly high with 88,917 unique website visitors last month. So our advertising is working. Year-to-date, staff have also set records for January through March with 179,000 unique visitors in 2016 compared to 100,000 in 2015 and right around 80,000 in 2014. So I think our website's working. Our message is getting out there. Our progress report, which you all have in front of you, points out a lot of these things too, and I hope you'll take those home with you. Marketing advertising programs have resulted in building a larger consumer database of potential visitors and a growing social media presence and increased economic impact. We had records that it's 127,000 loyal database customers. These are people who are asking us to send them information on a regular basis, not just one-time entries. Over 82,000 on social media responses, and we had $784 million last year in traveler spending in our region. Leveraging the ad dollars with our corporate sponsors made all this possible. Our sponsors are Legionnaire, Fink's Jewelers, Virginia Tech, and the Roanoke-Blacksburg Regional Airport, and we thank them for those partnerships. Virginia's Blue Ridge travel expenditures. Over 5 years ago, if you look at that graph, we're up $134 million last year over what our revenues were 5 years ago. That's a combination of a lot of marketing and a lot of good things happening in this area that are drawing people here. I'll talk about a little bit later some of the things that helped us with our budget, et cetera. Oops, got one too fast there. We've also had a lot of media visitors to our region, and these are the ones that write for a number of significant papers, such as the Dallas Morning News, Richmond Times-Dispatch, USA Today Travel, the Boston Globe, Virginia Craft Magazine, just to mention a few. It's amazing. You learn a lot when you work with the CVB of what goes on. If we had bought the space in the publications that we got from having them come visit us, it would have cost us $1.3 million. We got it done for less than $100,000 by bringing them in and putting them up to stay here and everything. So that's a pretty good return, 13 to 1 on the dollars that we're spending out there. Our progress report, we're pleased to report a jump in bureau partners. We now have 1,076 partners within the region that have elected to partner with us, and I think that's fabulous, but we'd like to head towards 2,000 now, as Landon would tell you, and get everybody to be our partners within the region for us to be bringing in more tourism for everyone here. We also, I'd like to recognize our board of directors. I'm not going to call the names. I'm going to put them all up there. And we have a good number of them here with us tonight. So if you are a member of the board of directors of the Roanoke Valley Convention and Visitors Bureau, I'd like for you to stand, please. And then all the numbers and the different things that you all have seen up there tonight and you'll see more of later tonight could not have happened if we didn't have just a fabulous staff that works at the CVB. And I'd like for all of the staff, and in this event tonight, they have really worked hard to put this on. When the numbers started growing, everybody's like, can we get everybody in there? And we were like, yeah, we'll make it work, because it's too important an evening and this is too great a venue. So our staff has really been over backwards to make this happen, and they do a great job day in and day out. Will all the staff please stand? Now we get to a little bit of the, excuse me. I know everybody's probably like me, allergies have been killing me this week thanks to all the beautiful, dry Virginia's Blue Ridge weather. We get now to some of our awards presentations, which is a fun part of this. And this is somebody, the first award I'll give is the Past Chairs Tourism Excellence Award, and is presented by the Bureau's Past Chairs recognition of an individual who exemplifies leadership, service, and commitment to the tourism industry in the Roanoke Valley and even the Commonwealth of Virginia. It is a recognition of an individual's lifetime achievements in developing and promoting our great industry. It's rare when a community as a new citizen move into town and immediately start to make a difference. But our Jeff Marks did. And regretfully, he's moved from Roanoke now, but he's with us in spirit, and he sent his best wishes to everybody here. In 2007, Jeff moved to Roanoke with over 30 years of experience in the broadcasting business to become manager and president and general manager of WDBJ7, the local CBS affiliate. Jeff hit the ground running. He promptly got on the boards of United Way of Roanoke Valley, Opera Roanoke, Roanoke Regional Chamber of Commerce, Better Business Bureau of Western Virginia, Virginia Western Community College, and the Roanoke Valley Convention and Visitor Bureau. Jeff's passion, leadership, energy, and resources, and hard work has made a tremendous positive impact on these and many other organizations. In 9 short years, Jeff has made a lifetime of difference in Virginia's Blue Ridge. And for that, we want to say thank you and recognize Jeff Marks as this year's recipient of the Past Chair's Tourism Excellence Award. I know he'll watch this on TV, so let's give him a applause. And we all miss Jeff for what he did in the valley. Okay. Our next award is the Golden Star Award, and it's presented to an individual or organization in recognition for outstanding service and commitment to facilitating economic growth in the tourism industry. The Bureau would like to recognize Rocky Mount's innovative development of the Harvester Performance Center, which has revolutionized the town's traditional business district by attracting more visitors and music lovers. The Harvester aggressively schedules music, comedy, and stage performances, putting on upwards of 170 shows annually with world-renowned acts on the venue's 2 stages. The Harvester's 2-story brick and steel shell was originally designed as a tractor dealership, hardware, and dry goods store in but the town of Rocky Mount Council purchased the building to refit it as a live performance venue. The impact of the economy was immediate, particularly in the hospitality and retail sectors, and town expects more tourism growth. Please help me congratulate the Harvester Performance Center in Rocky Mount, and we'd like to ask Matt Hankins to accept this award and congratulate all responsible in Franklin County for this.
Well, thank you. This is quite a surprise. I was surprised when the fine folks from Franklin County invited me to come and sit at their table tonight. Now I know why. So this is a partnership. It's something that's a partnership between the community, between all of our organizations, arts organizations throughout the valley. We all support each other. We realize and understand that people are economic development. Without people, we don't have spending in our restaurants and people staying in our hotels and dining. With us. We are so pleased to have been able to revolutionize Rocky Mount's arts scene, and we look forward to continuing to be a part of that for many years to come. Thank you for the award.
Thank you. The next award is the Patrick A. McMahon Tourism Ambassador Award, and it's presented annually to an individual or individuals for their outstanding efforts, dedication, and support towards promotion of the region and its many tourism attributes. This year's recipient is active in local, regional, and statewide tourism initiatives, including that of Virginia Mountain Region. She is a publisher, author, accomplished artist, and regular contributor to local, regional, and national publications. She enjoys everything to do with Smith Mountain Lake and can be applauded for her 50th anniversary's celebration leadership. She is driven to establish a designated community gathering facility at Smith Mountain Lake, better known as Vicky's Vision. It is my pleasure to announce that Vicky Gardner, Executive Director of the Smith Mountain Lake Chamber of Commerce, is this year's recipient of the Tourism Ambassador Award. Vicky, please come join us.
Oh. never did I expect. I have had so much love and so much support and help and prayers, and you just can't even imagine. And it just keeps right on coming. Yeah, I have a vision. Obviously, I was left here, and I have a mission, and I really hope to do everyone here proud. Thank you. This award means the world to me. Thank you so much.
And now it is my honor and privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, Tim Sands, 16th President of Virginia Tech, joining the university in 2014. He is a scientist, educator, and inventor, and has dedicated much of his career to advancing the impact of research and innovation in public education. He is currently engaged in a university-wide visioning initiative to expand Virginia Tech's role as a global land-grant institution that is equipped to confront the most challenging problems in the Commonwealth, the country, and the world. He holds a bachelor's degree in engineering physics and a master's degree and doctorate in material sciences from the University of California, Berkeley. Before coming to Virginia Tech, he was a provost at Purdue University. He is married to the Dr. Laura Sands, who is also with us tonight. I'm glad to have you, a professor of gerontology in the Department of Human Development at Virginia Tech, and is here with us this evening as well. I just told you that. They have four children, all graduates of Purdue. You can keep up with his thoughts and activities following him on Twitter, where he tweets as @VTSandsMan. And I'm going to learn how to Twitter before the evening's over so I can do that. Please welcome
tweeting,
me.
Okay.
Well, I'll learn how to tweet. Please welcome President Sands from Virginia Tech.
When I come to Roanoke, we come down the hill, but I never really feel like a visitor here, and that's because Roanoke is part of Virginia Tech. It's part of our larger community. And of course, having Hokie Stone behind us doesn't hurt. You know, we Hokies have this affinity to this dolomite limestone that decorates our campus, and we're happy to share it with the communities that we feel part of, and it makes us feel at home. Last night, we got to recognize 15 of our really incredible students who had demonstrated that they are VT-shaped students, and I will explain what that means later in my remarks. But we gave them each a little piece of Hokie stone, and these were little shards of yellowish, grayish things that you would chuck out in the yard if you didn't know that they were absolutely precious. But we're happy to share this little magic material with you, and it represents the expanse of Virginia Tech and the importance that Virginia Tech has in Roanoke, but also the connections that the importance of Roanoke to Virginia Tech. And so that will really be the theme of my remarks. I won't talk too long, I hope, but I thank you for entertaining me and giving me the opportunity to address you at this really critical time in Virginia Tech's history. This idea of Roanoke and this Blue Ridge region working with Virginia Tech is not a new one. It's something that when I think about first arriving here less than 2 years ago, Laura and I were on a plane coming in. I think I'd already been named. I knew I was going to be president of Virginia Tech before they let me visit. And as we were coming in, and Laura made a comment, "I'm home." And she looked out and saw the mountains, the Blue Ridge Mountains, and recognized we came from mountainous territory, and we were 12 years in an intervening period in the flatlands, and she came back and saw this this beautiful country and said, "This is definitely home." So when I saw Roanoke and Virginia Tech for the first time, and I think we felt this together, that it really is one community, and it's a very special place, and that's immediately apparent to our visitors. It's not something that is a stretch for them. They don't have the history of thinking of the various communities and having them develop separately. They think of it as one. But the reality is, as I got to know the history here, that the relationship between Virginia Tech and Roanoke really goes back at least to the 1980s. It probably goes back further than that. But at that time, I understand, and this is, please don't take this idea and run with it, but that Roanoke decided it needed its own state university. that Virginia Tech was out there in the hinterlands and Roanoke needed one of its own. But Mayor Noel Taylor had a different suggestion that Roanoke should adopt Virginia Tech. So this goes back to the 1980s. And this began a series of collaborative efforts that continue today. Virginia Tech's public radio station, WVTF, was already located in Roanoke, and rather than move it, we expanded it. The Roanoke Valley Virginia Tech Advisory Council formed back then. A direct route from Roanoke to Blacksburg was suggested, and that idea developed into the Smart Road, which I think one day will connect to Roanoke. We don't know exactly when, but we hope that happens. But that's a monument almost to the intent to connect these two regions of the state. We established programs at the Roanoke Higher Education Center, and the Virginia Tech Foundation invested in the Roanoke Symphony. Norfolk Southern, as you know, donated the Hotel Roanoke, and then the Virginia Tech Foundation, with the city of Roanoke as a partner and the community, renovated the Hotel Roanoke and built the adjacent or adjoining conference center. And that was a landmark moment for both Virginia Tech and for Roanoke. The creation of the Carilion Biomedical Institute launched an early research partnership that contributed to the development of the Virginia Tech Carilion School of Medicine and Research Institute. The SmartWay Bus is a collaborative effort that is helping connect our region. And that brings us to the present, and that is the anticipation of a new Health Science and Technology Innovation District based here in Roanoke that will connect Blacksburg and Montgomery County more directly to the city of Roanoke and to the region. We're in this exciting place today, and it's important to understand that it's the result of about 30 years of regional thinking and collaborative action by many of the people in this room. Virginia Tech's ready to grow, but our success depends on the development of a strong campus that views Blacksburg and Roanoke as a single region. We want to attract and retain the best talent. And that will take resources, opportunities, and a quality of life that we can best develop together. We need more space for students to learn, we need more spaces for students and faculty to live, and we need more opportunities for vibrant and healthy recreation and social experiences, more places to be exposed to new ideas and different people. And we can have all these things as a region. You know, one of the things I noticed coming into Virginia Tech was that our biggest challenges were along the lines of childcare is always an issue, and dual career issues. When we go out to recruit talent, we have to make the case that the spouse or partner will be able to continue their career and find something fulfilling. And although Blacksburg's a wonderful place and it has a lot of opportunities, it's small, and that's a challenge for us. So the more we can connect to Roanoke, the better. And going the other direction, recruiting people to Roanoke and to our Virginia Tech Carilion partnership has required that we offer the opportunities that are in Blacksburg. And neither region is really big enough on its own, so we view this, our future, as being intimately connected to the cooperation and the collaboration between these two regions. A generation ago, leaders in Roanoke and Virginia Tech had a vision for this region, and their foresight and work led us here. Today we have a vision for Virginia Tech, a generation into the future, and we're really excited about that vision, and you're part of that. I want to say just a couple of brief words about what we're doing at Virginia Tech, and Lee alluded to some of these activities. When I came into Virginia Tech, we were really in the midst of a strategic plan, and every institution does strategic planning, and we were in the middle of a 7-year strategic plan. There's nothing wrong with the strategic plan. It was absolutely fantastic, said the right things, but it was a 7-year or 8-year plan. And when you come into an institution like Virginia Tech, the future is much further in the distance. If you look at 7-year plans, you tend to do incremental things. And the opportunities here are to do big things. So we started an initiative called Beyond Boundaries, and we're looking at first, envisioning the future of Virginia Tech a generation from now. And we stumbled on to the year 2047. It happens to be our 125th or 75th anniversary. 150th will be 2022, and that will be a big deal around here and at Virginia Tech. So just to warn you, be thinking about 2022 because we're going to pull out all the stops. But 2047 is far enough in the future that you can drop some of the constraints that limit you in your strategic thinking in a typical situation. And so whenever we get around and talk about beyond boundaries, we think about the distant future, we always tell everybody to forget about what's affordable and also forget about what's legal. Let's think about what we could become without the constraints that we have today. And we'll build the realism into it later, but let's think about where we're headed. And that vision, although it's going to be a rolling process, I would say in the last 9 months, that vision has come to be quite clear. There are several elements to it that I'll mention, but it has helped us already think about our actions today. In other words, what we're going to do tomorrow to reach that vision in a generation's time. The second part to it is where a little bit of realism came in, and that is that the landscape for higher education is changing rapidly. And sometimes we ignore it, and we shouldn't. And when I say rapidly, I mean over a period of a generation. If you look at the way that higher education has been funded, you look at globalization, internationalization, all the demographics, all these trends, they have generation timescales, but generations go by quickly. I mean, I can think back to when I was an undergrad and when I was a new faculty member, and a lot of things about those experiences haven't changed, and some things have changed radically. We really owe it to ourselves to, in our planning, to account for the things that we know will change because they've been on a trajectory for the last generation. So the second part of what we're doing with Beyond Boundaries is to really think strategically about those long-term trends and build them into our planning. But the third element, which I think is really critical, is this idea of becoming a nimble institution, of becoming flexible. Because a lot of the things that we can imagine and we can project into the future will be critical. If we don't do that, there's no excuse. But there are some things that will happen to us and around us that we have no control over and we can't predict. And so we need to be able to be flexible. We need to be nimble. And so that's been another theme of Beyond Boundaries. But one of the things that's evolved out of it is absolute clarity over the fact that Virginia Tech and the Roanoke area, this region, they have to be one. And we have to think of them as one. But Virginia Tech is absolutely essential. We need to think of it as one. And going forward, we will. The other part to that is what we call the binary star. And that is the linkage of this area to the national capital region. And that's not to ignore any of the other important regions of Virginia. We are a land-grant institution, and we have an office in every county and every city. And we'll continue to accept that role of being the land-grant institution for Virginia. But if we think about the land-grant institutions from the Morrill Act from the 1860s and how that set us up, it was about economic development. It was about providing opportunity for students from the industrial classes, as they were put back then in the 1860s. So it was about providing a liberal education for students to become essentially to enable them to contribute to the economy, so the liberal plus the practical education, and to be part of our democracy. But it was also about economic development. And so we haven't lost that. We started off in agriculture and mechanic arts. We will stick to that. But these days, an equally important part of the land-grant mission is the urban part of it. And so we have two living laboratories, one in the National Capital Region and one here in Roanoke, to contribute to the economic development of the Commonwealth. And we see them as links. So we call this the binary star. So you'll hear a lot about this. Not only do we need to bring Roanoke and Blacksburg closer together, we need to bring this combined region closer to the National Capital Region. So that will be a theme of the next 25 years. If you, perhaps the most important facet of our vision and the part that makes us unique is the connection to our motto, ut prosum, that I may serve. We seek knowledge that serves the public good. You know, you've recently seen one of our faculty members and his team in action, Mark Edwards, in Flint, Michigan. And he embodies ut prosum. Well, thank you. You know, what Mark is doing and his team is just remarkable. It takes a lot of bravery because he's put his whole career on the line. He's done this multiple times, so this is not new for him. But this time, it's resonating, and the difference they're making is palpable for the people in Flint, Michigan. But this will be this is already a national issue. And when we talk to Mark and his colleagues about why they're doing what they're doing, they always talk about their aspirations for the human condition. And in his case, it's about clean and safe drinking water for everyone. And then he works backwards from there. In other words, what can I do to make sure that we have clean and safe drinking water for everyone? And all my actions will be tailored to meeting that goal. And that's a different way of thinking than is traditional in any institution, certainly in a university. So his example has really resonated, I think, with the entire campus in Blacksburg and Virginia Tech as a whole throughout the Commonwealth, that we need to rethink higher education in terms of the aspirations for the human condition that we would like to see improved and how we're going to get there working backwards from that idea. So you'll see that conversation coming up over and over as we think about the future of Virginia Tech. This has created a conversation also about the Virginia Tech student of the future. You probably heard the conversation about the T-shaped student or the T-shaped professional. And that's an individual who has incredible depth in their discipline, which is always going to be important, but who can cross the T with the ability to communicate across disciplines and to work with a diverse team to accomplish the big goals, the challenging and complex problems. Employers talk about this all the time. They want our students to be T-shaped. It's not good enough just to know your discipline. You have to know that. But you have to be able to work in a team. You have to be able to reduce data to actionable information. You have to be able to build a team. You have to know when to lead and when to be part of a team. You have to be a good communicator. You have to speak well. You have to write well. These are the skills that are really critical, and our employers constantly tell us that. And any of us know that from our own life experience. But building the education around the depth in the discipline and the crossing of the T across the disciplines and building those skills is going to be critical to defining the Virginia Tech student of the future. I actually think we're already there, but we've got to build it in a more purposeful and intentful way. But the special thing we've added is we now talk about the VT-shaped student. Now, okay, I will admit that if you're a UVA grad, you're never going to be advocating that UVA created VT-shaped students. But bear with me, because in fact, I think it's an aspiration they should share, and I think they do. The supporting structure for the T really is guided experiential learning and the informal communal learning that occurs in the campus environment. When you're working with teams, you're working with people, you're working with a student organization, some of that is structured, some of it's unstructured, but the internship, the undergraduate research, the study abroad, all of those are guided experiential learning that are so important to reinforcing the knowledge that our students gain in the traditional setting of the classroom or the laboratory. So another theme you will hear come out of our conversations about Beyond Boundaries going forward will be the VT-shaped student. And I think you'll enjoy that, because if you're an employer, that's what you're looking for, and we want to make sure that we offer that experience to all of our students. There are also VT-shaped communities and VT-shaped institutions. Virginia Tech as a whole is challenging itself to become a VT-shaped institution, not just to create that environment for our students, but to have an environment where the disciplines work together in teams to address complex problems, where we don't give up the strength of the discipline. We still must have these vertical structures where we have the aggregation of knowledge and the evaluation of quality, but you have to be able to work across those strengths. And the V in the institution's case comes from engaging the communities that we serve, being part of Roanoke and everything that happens here, part of Blacksburg, part of the National Capital Region, Richmond, the Tidewater area, Southern Virginia, Southwestern Virginia, all the regions of Virginia that we serve. And so we have a great laboratory. We have a great laboratory here in Roanoke. We have a great laboratory in the Arlington area. And these are part of the institution's fabric, part of what makes us a VT-shaped institution. The regional mindset is not always easy to achieve. So I do commend the Convention and Visitors Bureau and all those who are working toward regional solutions. We've heard a little bit about the challenges, but the opportunities are so great that I don't think we can let this go. This is such a huge opportunity for us, and frankly, it's absolutely critical to Virginia Tech. When I came to the region, when Laura and I came to the region 2 years ago, we were very excited about the possibilities. I really saw the strength of the community. This thing that we look at Virginia Tech of being a strength is our commitment to service, to APROSM, is something that the whole community shares. And when we recruit people to Virginia Tech and to the region and to our Virginia Tech Carilion Partnership here in Roanoke, we not only look for talent that is world class, but we look for people who are willing to engage the community and be part of the growth of the community. And I'd like to call out Mike Friedlander and his colleagues for the work that they've done with the Research Institute, and also Cinda Johnson, the School of Medicine, and Nancy Agee overall for Carilion Clinic, for really being in lockstep with this idea that we have at Virginia Tech, that community is important. Community is the thing that draws the talent to the region. One last point I would make, and that is that Laura and I are doing our own economic development activity. John's laughing here because he knows what I'm going to say. We've had three of our children who will be married in an 11-month period. There are four kids. So the fourth one, we just said, wait, give us a break. We tried to get all of them to come to Roanoke because we just thought this would be a great setting. The Hotel Roanoke, the local churches, and there's so many things, the restaurants. Our third child succumbed. She's living in Lexington, Kentucky, and she and her husband-to-be will be married here in almost exactly 1 month. She looked around Lexington, nothing wrong with Lexington, but she said, Mom, Dad, I'm not finding what I'm looking for. We kind of winked at her and said, come on out to Roanoke and have a look. So about 30 days from now, 140 West Coast folks and people from the Midwest will fly into the Hotel Roanoke, cross our fingers, and so we'll be helping to develop the region here by doing a little tourism of our own. And maybe I didn't talk about it in detail, but I'd just like to say a little bit, because you're going to hear more and more about it, about our efforts to create a health science and technology innovation district in Roanoke. And you've probably already heard a little bit because some of it's been in the press, but we received bonding authority or construction authority for the next building, $45 million from the state. We're going to be putting in what will total much more than that. We'll more probably triple that amount in investment over the next 5 years between Carilion Clinic, Virginia Tech, and our new partners. We're really looking to expand the partnership. Our work with Carilion Clinic has been phenomenal so far. They've been a fantastic partner. It's such a great example of a public-private partnership, and the state constantly points that out, that this is really an amazing partnership, an exemplar for how to do these kinds of relationships. But we think that we can go a lot further than what we've done so far. The last 7 years or so, we've had a lot of successes. The Virginia Tech Carilion School of Medicine is preparing to graduate its third class. Each one of those individuals, 100% of all three classes, has received their residency choice. The matching is 100%. This year, we have something like 4,600 applications for our 42 School of Medicine slots in our entering class. Hard to believe it's come so far. The reason it's worked so well is the community's strong. People who visit recognize the quality of life here. Our students, prospective students, recognize that. The focus on research has made it unique. All of our students are engaged in research. And the interprofessional training they have and the problem-based curriculum, those are all the kinds of things you would do if you set up a medical school right today. We don't have the legacy issue, so we're able to do it right from the beginning, and it's really making a difference. The Research Institute has had over $100 million in research expenditures. The impact of the two has been estimated at close to $250 million over the last several years. But we're not satisfied with that. That's a great start. It's a way to go. You know, we demonstrated the concept, proof of concept, but we can do a lot more than that. And the vision for the Health Science and Technology Innovation District will bring in more partners. It'll be bigger. It'll bring in talent at the physician scientist level that we seek to grow. It'll make Roanoke and Virginia Tech a destination for talent. And in that sense, we are perfectly aligned with the theme of today's meeting. So I won't tell you more right now. More will come out. But it'll be big, it'll be bold, and it will make a huge difference in everybody's lives here and in Virginia Tech's future. So thank you for your attention. Look forward to being partners with you going forward. And I hope to see you out in Lane Stadium not too long from now, just a few more months. And I hope to see you in Castle as well. But come and enjoy our restaurants in Blacksburg. We spend a lot of time in the restaurants in Roanoke. It's all one community, and Virginia Tech's very proud to be part of it. Thank you.
Eric Fitzpatrick is one of our very well-known local artists. And if you have a little something over here, we would like you to have to do more to remember our area with, if I can get this off. But this is beautiful. Original by Eric and the beautiful mountains we live in.
You know, I am one of those wahoos he was talking about. But I am also one of those wahoos that knows the importance of Virginia Tech to the Roanoke Valley. And I remember about 10, 12 years ago, I was in a meeting, and Charlie Steger and Ray Smoot, who I'll tell their ages because we're all within 1 year of each other, and I think maybe Menace was here, and I said, who's coming to Roanoke when we all retire? And I'll tell you, when I met Dr. Sands, the first time I met him was at the anniversary of the renovation and reopening of the Hotel Roanoke. And I will quote one thing he said at the end, and I knew that we were okay. And at the end, he talked about the hotel and people talking about the hotel not being on Virginia Tech's campus. And his closing remarks were, so now when people ask me why we have a hotel that's not on our campus, I tell them we don't. Well, I can tell you, Ray Smoot and I looked at each other, okay, what's coming now? And it was great because he said, we consider Roanoke an extension of Tech's campus. And we're so happy that you feel that. Thank you. All right, I've asked some of our elected officials and our city managers and county administrators if they would mosey up this way. You had to earn your dinner. At this time, I'd like to make a very special tourism announcement. After 31 years of doing business as the Roanoke Valley Convention and Visitors Bureau, the official designation marketing organization for the region, the Bureau is proud to officially unveil its new name. If y'all will unroll, Visit Virginia's Blue Ridge, effective April 21, 2016. That is our name. I'd like to thank the localities that have already adopted this. Roanoke County was the first, jumped out in the lead, thanks to Jason. Ray Ferris up here was a big pusher for Roanoke City to get there. Salem has adopted it. Botetourt, I believe, has it on their agenda next week. And I'm sure we're going to get Brent to adopt it here before too long.
Come see
We're working it. We're going to come see you. So let's have a round of applause for all these that have supported Virginia 3 years. I'm going to take just a brief minute or two to talk about a little bit about where we've been and where we're going. And I promise I'm not going to take very long. You know, a lot of things have happened in the last 4 years, 4 or 5 years. I lose sight of how long I've been involved with this. One of the first big things that we worked on when Landon got here was we were a $1 to $1.1 million a year agency. Well, that doesn't buy you much advertising. And he went to work putting together a funding formula that we went to the localities with. And we were able to secure, through a lot of hard work from our three main funders, Roanoke City, Roanoke County, and City of Salem, a funding agreement that gave us a 3-year evergreen contract, which meant we could start thinking more than 12 months at a time. Not only that, we were able to increase the transient occupancy tax, and that has boosted our budget from 1.1, 1.2 to over $3 million a year. And that is huge for us. We're still way behind our competitors that we compete against, Asheville, Raleigh, Richmond, but we're making progress. Photo I have up there, we call it, what's your name for it?
Camp David Accord.
I guess we ought to call it the Camp Virginia's Blue Ridge Accord, but this is a photo of all the people that were involved in getting us permission from the state and wherever else we needed it increase the occupancy tax in our funding agreement. Well, right after that, you know, Landon brought up something else, and this is something else we talked to Dr. Sands about. I remember a conversation about this, that we didn't have mountains in Virginia. Or at least if you picked up the Virginia Tourism Guide, it did not recognize mountains being in Virginia. So if you searched for a vacation for mountains, you kind of went back to their home page. Beaches were all over the place, but you didn't have mountains here. And I remember Dr. Sands saying to Ray and I, "You mean these beautiful mountains I see out here just popped up in the last 6 months?" And I said, "Yes, sir. According to Virginia Tourism, they did." But we went to work and we were able to get the region known as Virginia Mountains Region. And we have 11 localities that are in that region now. And now we advertise ourselves as a place to come for mountain vacations. Instead of so many people streaming down 81, going to North Carolina and Tennessee mountains because they've been advertising them for years. And that was a real push for Landon and something that we all worked very hard on. I never knew when I got in this job that tourism was quite as political as it is, but it is probably one of the most political things I've ever been involved in. We also were able, as we did our mountain region, we also got our logo. Virginia is for mountain lovers. So those are things we've accomplished. 2 years ago, and I know a lot of you, if you've been in our meetings, you heard about our great partnership with Kroger. That turned out a lot of good things for us. We had a campaign that ran 16 weeks with them, mainly in the Richmond, Raleigh, Durham market. We got tremendous participation from those markets, and it was calculated that the value of that campaign, which cost us about $400,000 or less, was $21.6 million. We are still reaping the benefits of the people we made connections with at that campaign. Another thing that Landon brought to us was thinking regionally and much broader. So then we moved into our destination vision plan, and some of you will see yourselves in the different meetings we have here. But we got together to figure out what do we need to do to secure the future of tourism in this region. Landon will tell you, we're doing great right now, but if we don't have a couple wins here in the next few years and new things to show people, that curve has been going up. It's been going up for 6 years. Start turning down, and I know none of our partners want to see that happen. So we set out with a lot of the people in this room, a lot of the professionals, to put together a 2030 destination visioning plan. We use something called mind maps. That's all of them working at tables on mind maps. And that's what our mind map looked like when we sent our consultant back home to figure out how he put that into something we could digest and work on in about 5-year increments. At the first part of June, we should have from him our strategic plan, and we will hopefully adopt at our June board meeting at least the plan for how we move through the first 5 years of it. This has got to be our future to keep us on the map and continue to increase the great things that have happened here. And speaking of great things that have happened here, I'm just going to quickly run through some of these. Rail Yard Dogs, that's our new hockey team that will start here next fall. Haven't had hockey for a while. Amtrak, be here next year?
Next summer.
Next summer. That's going to be huge for us. That's going to open up international markets because, you know, Europe, Asia, they're all in love with the rail. So they'll be able to come in to Dulles, jump on the metro, go downtown, get on Amtrak and show up right here, where we've got the best metro mountain mix that they can visit close to Washington, D.C. Salvage Dogs, we were talking about that earlier today. They're one of our great attractions. And I tell you, I drive by them a lot on Saturday morning when tourists are in town. You can't get in there to do your own shopping. So they've done a great job and on TV and everything. Explore Park. You know, we are touting the region as a great outdoors. All of us are, and it is. Well, Explore Park is working on their master plan now. And it can just be a fabulous destination, not just for the people in the region, but nationally to bring people in here for the diversity that we can have in that park. The Chutes, we all know what that did for us. I mean, that was a huge win for this area, and I told people if we lost that, I think that was worse than some of the others that everybody thought was death. They're here, and they're here because of what we have to offer as a way of life. And I think people that talked to them while they were looking said, you know, they were more concerned about what kind of quality of life their employees were going to have than what it might take to get their trucks on Route 81, on Interstate 81, to start delivering their product. That's the kind of companies that we want here. We've got a great one coming. Another thing that's going to be fun, I think it's happening on a night that might be kind of spoken about earlier tonight. Let me cut this off. I haven't found the... We want to be the best biking location on the East Coast. And we're working with that. And we've got a lot of groups working towards that. We've got a great event called Virginia's Blue Ridge Downtown Twilight Criterium. Now, if any of you are like me, when I first got involved in trying to make this happen, I'm like, okay, tell me what a criterium is, because I didn't know. But it is Tour de France style biking. It will happen in downtown Roanoke on the night of May the 21st, starts about 6 o'clock, and it'll be a great place for everybody that's at the wedding. I think you can reduce the reception a little bit, and they'll be able to come out and drink on the streets and have a great time. But it's the kind of thing where we wanted to be sure we did something to stress how important biking is to this region and that people could see. So we're partnering with the Roanoke Regional Partnership on this. Pete Eshelman has helped us tremendously, and we hope this will be a great event that will become an annual event in the downtown area. Our greenways, we hear all the time about what fabulous greenways, and the progress being made to complete those and tie them all together gives us something that not just our citizens enjoy, but we hear about it from the tourists that come in here to visit that, gosh, we can get out and walk so many places and things of that nature. So that's a huge thing for us to do. They snuck this picture in on me. It was a great trip. But the fire up 611, I mean, that's with what rail history is here, that's a whole other thing for tourism for us. My grandson and I had a great trip on that. It's a memory both of us have forever. Hotels. We got one up here, I think it's going to open sometime before too long. It has been a little late. I can remember when I was in the construction business, who I was building for would not have been happy if I'd taken quite that long to get it built. But I think we'll see it, and We also believe that we will see several other hotels coming online pretty soon after. You can't have people coming in here like they're coming in, spending the money they're spending without people realizing that investing in this region is also something good to do. Eldor coming in out at Botetourt. I give Gary LaRue credit for this wonderful picture over here, the president of Eldor, who in the paper said, we picked it because we love the mountains. So what does that say for our Metro Mountain mix? I'm not going to repeat what all Dr. Sands said in his thing, but our partnership with Virginia Tech and Korean is huge, absolutely huge. And he mentioned what Michael Freelander and his staff has done down there. And the number of people that this is going to bring in over the next few years is just really big for our area. We're really very, very happy that we have not only that facility there, but that it is going to grow the way it's going to grow. One of our main priorities for the upcoming year, I wanted to let you know, all this has kind of been history up to the day, will be to market our own region to our own region. Now, that may sound funny to you, but you know, we spent a lot of money marketing away from here. We got a lot of people from outside coming. A lot of the people right here that need to be ambassadors for what's happening in our region, understanding the opportunities for businesses, et cetera, don't realize what tourism really is. So Landon's kind of working on the corporate structure of the Visit Virginia's Blue Ridge organization to allow for part of it to be focused on marketing here and seeing that our destination vision plan moves forward. That's our key. We can't do it all. We can help facilitate it, but it's our key to keep that in front of the region so that we can move forward with some of the things that are on it that people have deemed to be very important and those things that are necessary to attract not just businesses, but residents to come here, people that are looking for good jobs and good life. That's what we have here. We've got a great place. Landon likes to say, we worked hard over the last 4 years, and everybody in this room can spell the word tourism. We're really going to work now on getting everybody to work on spelling the word destination, which we can all say is Virginia's Blue Ridge. Let's thank our sponsors one more time for making tonight possible. I want to certainly thank Dr. Sands for coming and being our keynote speaker and for his enthusiasm on the partnership between our region and Virginia Tech. All right, got a little housekeeping to do. All of you have a gift bag. It's got your ticket Della was talking about in it. And remember, 20 people come with you, that ticket gets you in free. But really do try to bring some friends with you so we can support a very important event here at the Taubman. Also, we've got some, I think, very, very appropriate centerpieces. And we decided that the best way to maybe decide who got to take the centerpiece home is whoever's birthday is closest to Norman Rockwell's birthday of February the 3rd. You don't have to say years, and I didn't say his year, just the day. So we'll let you all decide that. The art gallery is open until 9 p.m. if you want to run upstairs and see. We hope you all have a wonderful rest of your evening in Virginia's Blue Ridge. Y'all might actually catch some of the last songs from Huey Lewis in the news if you want to go to Elmwood Park. But thank you all for being here. It's been a great evening. Thank you.